The world we live in is a colorful one because chromophores and pigments are naturally produced. Not only do they make brilliant colors, but nature utilizes them to harvest the energy from the sunlight. I'll take you through a very quick tour of some of the chromophores that are found in nature, and the main thing I want you to pay attention to is the extended pi delocalization that's seen in these systems. We've already seen the structure of chlorophyll, and you can notice that there's an extended pi delocalization contiguous sp2 hybridized carbon and nitrogen around the ring of this molecule. The carotenoid pigments are shown here. These show up in the red color of tomatoes. You can see the very extended pi delocalization alternating double and single bonds. This is a conjugated undecane. Carrots also have a rich color, and they're due to alpha carotene and beta carotene, very similar structures that are shown here, differing only in the presence of an sp3 hybridized carbon there versus another double bond in the case of beta carotene. The anthocyanidins are the pigments that are responsible for the colors that we see in many flowers and budding plants. They have the structures that are shown here, and these are known as perillium salts, and we'll learn about perillium salts and other aromatic systems a little bit later on in the semester. The brilliant red color that we associate with beets is due to the pigment that's known as betanin, whose molecular structure is shown here. This pi system has an interesting donor-acceptor relationship. The lone pair on this nitrogen can be donated into the low-lying pi star orbital of this delocalized unit. The motif that's common to color-generating molecules is extended pi delocalization. We know how to calculate the molecular orbital energies for such systems, and I hope you've been able to see that there's a direct relationship between the color that's observed and the molecular orbital energies that we're able to calculate.